Let me continue now by calling Professor Papadimos to the podium. In the interest of saving time, and because certainly the CVs of all the people in the panel are well known, I will not go through everything. Let me welcome Professor Papadimos, and please.
Thank you very much. Let me start by first saying that I'm delighted to participate in this first Delphi Economic Forum with so many outstanding speakers and such a distinguished audience. Now, I was told that the working language is not Greek, so I have prepared my remarks accordingly, and I want to reduce the risk of being lost in translation. Ladies and gentlemen, it seems incredible, and yet it's true. Είναι απίστευτο και όμως αληθινό. 6 years have gone by since the Greek debt crisis broke out in 2010, and our country's main economic problems have not yet been resolved. Despite the significant, indeed great, progress made in improving the country's fiscal position, public finances are not yet considered to be sustainable. And debt restructuring is once again on the top of the policy agenda. More importantly, the Greek economy, after having contracted by more than 25% over the past 8 years, remains weak. International institutions project that GDP is likely to decline this year, and they predict a rather modest rate of growth in the next 2 years, although I have to say there is a lot of uncertainty about these projections. Unemployment is still very high at 25%, is expected to go down very slightly, and I believe is the main economic and social program we are facing today. Uncertainty about the economic outlook is high. Confidence is low. People have become increasingly disappointed and indignant, and some are desperate and others are angry. A large part of the population justifiably feel and say, this situation cannot go on. Δεν πάει άλλο. Moreover, the growing refugee crisis is creating serious problems and is threatening to make an already difficult economic situation even worse. It's clear that decisive and effective action is needed on many fronts. But if we are going to move forward from the current impasse and malaise, it is important to make the economy grow again, to strengthen economic recovery and establish the conditions which are going to ensure strong and durable growth. Now, this is easier said than done. There is broad public and political support for this objective, but it has been elusive. We have failed to achieve it. And there are alternative views on how we are going to achieve it, which reflect a different understanding and a different assessment of economic and institutional realities. Now, in my remarks, I will focus on 3 key issues relating to the topic of our session today. First is, what is the appropriate strategy for achieving the growth objective, given constraints that we face and given certain prominent features of the Greek economy? Second, what are the policies and reforms which are necessary for successful implementation of the strategy? And what are other necessary conditions? And third, what are the country's prospects for strong recovery and durable growth in the years to come? In addressing the first question, let me first stress that the growth strategy will be successful in achieving its objective if it meets 4 criteria. First, it's formulated on the basis of a correct identification of the factors which have inhibited growth and job creation in the past. Second, if it employs instruments that can effectively achieve the goal. Third, if it can help restore public trust and market confidence. and if it can be implemented in a manner that preserves and indeed strengthens social cohesion. All these criteria or features are very important, but I believe that at the present juncture, restoring confidence and fostering a sentiment of social justice are particularly important. Now, given the country's still excessive public debt, the objective of the BRAC strategy, and this is the challenge for policy, is to achieve high and durable growth while securing debt sustainability. Fiscal policy is generally constrained by the need to reduce public debt to a level which is considered sustainable, but at present it is specifically constrained in order to meet the primary budget surpluses which are included in the third program. These targets presumably will be amended following some agreement on debt relief, but they will not go away. There will still be constraints on fiscal policy. However, fiscal policy can play an important role in promoting growth through fiscal reforms and the adoption of an appropriate tax system. In the light of these general considerations and taking into account the various factors that have affected and inhibited growth in the past, the factors that have contributed to the severity and the persistence of the recession, I believe that a growth strategy in Greece should be based on three main pillars and have certain other characteristics. First and foremost, deep and broader reforms are needed to improve the functioning of markets and the functioning of institutions. More specifically, we desperately need reforms to increase the efficiency and the quality of public administration, to improve the functioning of labor, product, and services markets, and enhance reforms to enhance human capital through better education and training. And such reforms are necessary in order to raise productivity, the point that was emphasized a lot by Professor Sakellaris. Raising productivity is an intermediate objective. We have to see how to achieve that. So such reforms will be important for raising productivity, for encouraging investment, strengthening structural competitiveness, and boosting exports, which are essential ingredients for improving the growth performance of the Greek economy over the medium and longer term. Now, there are two pertinent points I would like to emphasize. A more efficient and effective public sector, which I remind includes the justice system and the tax revenue system, is important in itself, but is also indispensable for the successful implementation of other reforms. And second, the other point is that we urgently need reforms to create an institutional, cultural, and entrepreneurial environment that fosters competition and stimulates innovation. Competition and innovation are key ingredients for higher and durable growth. Now, the second pillar of the growth strategy concerns the financial system. Alleviating the persisting credit crunch and improving the financing of small and medium-sized firms should remain key priorities. At present, the capacity of the banking system is constrained by three factors: the exceptionally high share of non-performing loans, the sizable outflow of deposits, and the substantial borrowing requirements of the government. Now, the recapitalization of the Greek banks, which was recently completed, the second big recapitalization, was absolutely necessary for easing the credit crunch. But it is not sufficient. Reducing the share of non-performing loans in a systematic and substantial way is essential, as also the governor of the Bank of Greece emphasized yesterday, for easing the credit constraints and increasing the capacity of banks to provide credit to healthy firms. And I should add here that improving the financing of the economy significantly should not rely solely on the domestic banking system. I think there is a clear need, and I believe there is ample scope, to advance other forms of funding the private sector, especially for the smaller enterprises and the startups. Now, the third pillar involves policies that can stimulate aggregate demand directly over the short and medium term. Because most reforms
First of all, they
time to be fully implemented. And second, their positive effects on activity and employment could occur with fairly long lags. It is necessary to use other policy instruments that can speed up recovery and reduce unemployment faster by strengthening aggregate demand in a timely fashion. I think this is also important for improving market sentiment and expectations about the future in the long term, which will further boost spending and activity. Now, there are several policies that are available and implemented in principle. I have no time to elaborate, but let me simply mention that some of them are promoted by the European Investment Bank and can be financed by the European Structural Funds, and progress is being made on this front. And the Juncker Plan for the substantial increase in public investment provides another mechanism for increasing investment in Greece in a way which can positive effects both on the short term by stimulating investment and in the long term by enhancing potential growth. And an associated remark is that this type of investment should not be limited into the traditional forms of constructing highways and building bridges, but should involve investment in energy, education, healthcare services, and the infrastructure necessary to foster technological advances and innovation in various fields. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you may justifiably ask, can such a growth strategy and the associated policies be implemented under the present circumstances and yield the expected benefits in a timely manner? And more generally, can our country pull itself together and finally resolve the crisis and get the economy out of its current state of stagnation? Let me highlight some necessary conditions which are political, institutional, and economic for the successful implementation of the strategy outlined, and then conclude by assessing the outlook for growth. First, these are the economic conditions. In my view, it is essential that the reforms and the policies associated with the three pillars of the strategy are not only implemented effectively, but also implemented simultaneously. If this is done, they will have mutually reinforcing positive effects through various channels, including improving confidence and expectations, and thus bring the economy faster to a path of durable growth. Second, in case of delays or shortcomings in the introduction of reforms and in the consolidation of public finances, priority should be given to speeding up the pursuit of the reform agenda. In particular, in assessing the progress made in the implementation of the third program, greater emphasis should be placed on the completion of the agreed reforms relative to the achievement of short-term fiscal objectives. Now, needless to say, structural reforms and fiscal consolidations are equally important. Yet we should avoid, and we refer both to the governments and to the institutions, the mistake made in the past of overemphasizing the attainment of the fiscal targets in the short run at the cost of the introduction of growth-enhancing reforms, which would have supported activity and greatly facilitated fiscal consolidation in the longer run. This observation brings me to the third point, which concerns the need for debt restructuring and relief and its implications for the economy's future growth. Let me say briefly two things. The issue is on the agenda tomorrow on the program. The first is to understand that the main reason why public debt continues to be a policy constraining factor and a burden of the economy is not insufficient fiscal adjustment or inadequate debt restructuring in the past. It is the much lower than previously predicted growth of the economy since the onset of the crisis. I can briefly remind you that over the first 5 years of the adjustment program, the primary budget deficit was reduced by an impressive 10.5% of GDP. Moreover, the debt restructuring of 2012 not only reduced the face value of the outstanding debt by 106 billion, or 53% in the face value, but it also extended the maturities and reduced the cost of the debt held by the private sector. And as a result, it improved substantially the profile of amortization and interest payments in the future. If the PSI had not taken place, the debt-to-GDP ratio at the end of 2014 would have been 230% approximately, compared to 177, which is the actual figure. So, in 2014, the European institutions assessed that the Greek public debt was sustainable and that it was gradually going to be reduced 100%, and indeed less than 100%, by the year 2022. Regrettably, however, the deterioration of financing and economic conditions last year and the downward revision of growth rates and the expected primary surpluses and a number of other factors have made again debt sustainability an issue. And according to the latest published assessment of the European institutions, the debt-to-GDP ratio is expected, first of all, to rise a little bit and then decline to 175% and 106% in the years 2020 and 2022, respectively, way above the targets that had been assumed as sustainable in 2012. Now, of course, the issue of debt sustainability has various dimensions, and views have been expressed both by officials and academics whether a debt restructuring is necessary. My view is that debt relief is now necessary, as this would create more room for maneuver for fiscal policy and will help stimulate aggregate demand. But I think you all know that the agreement reached in July 2015 implies that there won't be any nominal haircut of the face value of the debt, and any debt relief will take the form of extension of maturities and grace periods for repaying interest and principal. So, having said this, the issue here relevant for our discussion is, will such debt relief be the crucial step that will lead to the resolution of the Greek crisis and the attainment of higher and durable growth? My simple answer is no. Debt relief is absolutely necessary, and I support it, because it will improve the debt servicing and will allow the adoption of a more, let's say, moderate fiscal stance. But it is not sufficient, first of all, to deal permanently with the burden of debt on the economy and also to return the Greek economy to a durable growth. So what are the prospects? And I'm concluding with this. Looking ahead, a growth strategy and a reform agenda will succeed in achieving its objectives only if, in addition to adopting the right strategy and the right tools, we reach a political consensus on the primary objective and the overall framework that will foster, and also we develop the social values and the institutions that will support and foster the effective implementation of reforms. Hence, I think it's essential in our discussion today not only to focus on the features of the policies on the reforms, but also on how we can create the institutional, social, and political environment which is necessary for their adoption and completion. Now, in view of the above, I can envisage three possible growth scenarios: the good, the bad, and the ugly. Let me close on a positive note by concentrating on the good scenario. This will unfold if the third program for Greece is effectively implemented, starting with the successful completion of the first assessment in the coming weeks or months. But as I have argued before, achieving durable growth in Greece will require broader and deeper reforms, as well as other actions along the lines of the strategy and conditions I outline. Progress to this end, and during the year, next one, could trigger the start of a virtuous circle of increased confidence and improved financing for the economy, which will be supported by the policies of the European Central Bank regarding the provision of direct, long-term credit to Greek banks and the inclusion of Greek bonds in the ECB's asset purchase program. These policies are conditional on program implementation. Now, the bad scenario would be characterized by delays and shortcomings in enacting the appropriate policies, by repeating the past mistakes in an environment of political mistrust and bickering, growing social tensions as economic weakness and unemployment will persist, while the relations of Greece with its European partners will deteriorate. Now, such scenario is undesirable not only because of the bad short-term effects it will have, but because it's inherently unstable. It will evolve into the ugly one. I think we should all realize that the probability of a fourth program is nil. And in that case, the ugly scenario leading to Greece's exit from the euro will unfold. I still believe, and I'm closing with this, and definitely hope that a good scenario is the likely one. Both the government and most opposition parties understand the implications of failure, and they also the need for resolving the ongoing crisis. And they both have strong political incentives to move forward. And I have to say I was encouraged by many of the points made by Mr. Dragasakis earlier on. At the same time, we are all very much realize that this possible outcome, which I consider likely, is far from certain. There are various obstacles and several risks which can prevent the materialization of the desirable path to economic recovery and durable growth. Ladies and gentlemen, being in Delphi, I thought it appropriate to consult the oracle for advice. Pythia was not to be found this morning, but I listened very carefully to the sound of water from the Castalia Springs and reflected on what could have been a positive message. As could have been expected, the message was ambiguous and difficult to interpret. But then I recall that on the temple of Apollo, there are two sayings. One says, "Know thyself," and the second, "Nothing too much." And this helped me to reach an interpretation of what would have been the oracle's advice regarding our strategies and policies for growth in the future. And it's this: learn from your mistakes. Do not talk too much, but act. Act well, act together, and act fast. You are running out of time. Thank you. And I apologize for having run out of my own time.
Thank you very much, Professor Papadimos.